So here tonight, we're gathered to hear a lecture by a brilliant person with an area of expertise that may be a little unfamiliar to some of us. Might even be from a galaxy far, far away.
I am a kid, I guess.
That was for you. And then we're going to sit down together to a beautiful meal presented by one of the city's finest chefs, who I will be introducing. And we're here to bring together a room full of some of the city's most exciting artists right here, so that we can meet one another and learn new things. The tagline for the series, in short, we want to unite, inspire, nourish, and connect. I want to introduce the people in the room making all this possible and out of the room making all this possible. First and foremost, our partner in Elective Studies Supper Club, Land and Sea Department. Working at our headquarters right now. Land and Sea Department is a company that encompasses many, many different projects and aesthetics and, one aesthetic.
And babes.
You can read more about them in programs at your table, and you definitely should. But the point person on the Land and Sea side who makes all this possible is Steph Krim, right behind you. Part of welcoming us into this space and making it all possible. And don't slink away, Eric Reeves, because the amazing Eric Reeves is also from Land and Sea Department, is also from the Cherry Circle Room. He's one of the managers at the Cherry Circle Room at the Chicago Athletic Association. If you haven't been, you ought to go. It's amazing. He is master of service tonight, so he's making everything beautiful and well-oiled and making us all feel celebrated and welcome, and he's wonderful. I elusively mentioned a fabulous chef earlier, but now it's time to just gaze lovingly at the chopper. Don't look at us, though. That makes me nervous while you're chopping. That is Chef Mickey Neely. All throughout Europe and many, many places beyond. He's in the, can I say what your project is?
Yeah.
It's in your bio, okay. He's in the process of opening, he's working on opening a new sandwich shop called Dibs. And it's gonna be in the Ukrainian village-ish area.
Yes!
Humboldt Park.
Okay.
You should talk to him more about it. Close. It's very close here. Just north of here.
Here.
Yes. I also really want to thank the Joyce Foundation, without whose generous support we would not all be gathered here today. They are amazing. And then we have some incredible sponsors whose fruits we are enjoying. Leatherbee Distillers, who are enjoying a cocktail courtesy of Leatherbee Distillers right now. Is Brent here?
He's here.
Yeah. He had to run.
Oh. Wait. He was here.
Yeah, playing now.
Okay, yeah. Celebrity Brent Angle of Leatherbee Distillers is going to be among us later, so make sure to thank him. He's wonderful. Lagunitas Brewing Company, whose beers you'll be enjoying later with dinner, and Perrier, whose wares are on the tables. Also, all of you were invited here tonight. As you know, if you're wondering how the invitation list works, basically, we send out these invitations to practicing artists from around the city. There's no way we will ever have everyone on that list. So if you know people who would like to be included, all they need to do is email us at electivestudies@ilhumanities.org. That's the email from which you've received your invitations. And just tell us a couple sentences about their artistic practice, and we'll add them to the list, and we're really interested in doing that. In order to provide access to the content from tonight's lecture for the people who weren't able to be here tonight, because there was a long waiting list. We have some amazing documentarians here with us to capture the lecture so that we'll be able to put it up on our website. We have the Goodnight Ladies here, Eve Redberg and Jessica Marks. There she is, Jess Marks, right there. Thank you so much. And then we also have the phenomenal Matthew Gregory Hollis over here. I'm documenting everything this evening. I'm almost done, I promise. If you want to, so social media about tonight, and I encourage you to do so. Hashtag is just Elective Studies. We're at IL Humanities on social media. Shane, I think, will probably share his handle with you at the beginning. It's already shared with you right there. Science Jedi. It's also in the programs. Okay, so as previously stated, Elective Studies Supper Club events are designed to give us a chance to step outside of the arts. Tonight's topic gives us a chance to step outside of ourselves, really, really far outside of ourselves. And doing that can feel alienating. Not alone in the universe. In the eternal words of Michael Jackson, you are not alone. I am here with you. Though we're far apart, you're always in my heart. And perhaps after we learn what we're going to learn tonight, we'll all want to sing that to the stars as we exit. Perhaps not. But either way, we're in for a truly delightful treat. I have to tell you a tiny bit about our speaker before I let him take over. Dr. Shane Larson is a research associate professor of physics at Northwestern University, where he's a member of CIERA, the Center for Interdisciplinary Exploration and Research in Astrophysics, and he's an astronomer at the Adler Planetarium. He works in the field of gravitational wave astrophysics, specializing in the studies of compact stars, binaries, and the galaxy. He works in gravitational wave astronomy with both the ground-based LIGO project and future space-based detectors for NASA. And you can read the rest of his bio in your program, but you should also know that Shane builds his own giant telescopes, and he brought one of them up to Solanathon Artist Retreat that I run for my side gig up in Wisconsin, and showed us Saturn and the rings on Saturn and the moons around Saturn, and answered a barrage of extremely frenzied and excited questions from a bunch of artists, of which Diana was one. And all of that led to tonight's talk, actually. That's where the genesis of tonight's talk began. And so, just as we artists all geek out about our individual practices and what we do, so too does Shane about his field. And I just want to emphasize what we all already know. Just like it's a gift and a delight to be in the presence of someone who spent hours and years fine-tuning their artistic talent, it's also just a gift and a delight to be in the presence of someone who has such deep knowledge and expertise in his own field. So to hand the floor off to Shane, I want to quote his favorite Serbian proverb that he shared with me. I hope I'm not stealing that from your talk.
No, you're not.
It's become one of my favorite quotes as well. Be humble, for you are made of earth. Be noble, for you are made of stars. Mm. Please welcome Dr. Shane Larson.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. I do want to thank Jane and Illinois Humanities for having me. Great opportunity to do elective studies last year, and so we had a great night. That's where I met Mickey, actually, and so we've all become fast friends now, and so it's a great pleasure to be back and talk to you about things that are very near and dear to my heart and have a much bigger conversation with people who think about things differently and in other ways than we nerdy scientists think about them every day, right? So tonight, I want to talk about life in the universe, and this is one of the biggest questions that we can ask as humans. And I like this question because on the surface, it seems quite fanciful. If someone walked up to you and said, let's talk about life in the universe, it kind of makes you want to go grab your sketchbook and run off on your own and draw pictures of bug-eyed monsters with eye stalks and tentacles and horns and all kinds of stuff that you don't see on the Earth. But what I love about it is it's really a serious question too. And as we'll see tonight, there are very definite things that we as scientists, as astronomers and physicists and chemists, have to say about life in the universe. But at the same time, anytime I want to tell you about those scientific things I can say, it inspires in all of us these really kind of deep questions
that maybe are or maybe aren't scientific. We want to think about and talk about life in language that we're all very used to and is very personal. We talk about being alone in the universe and finding friends elsewhere. And when I talk about being alone, and when I talk about finding friends, all of us have this deep emotional core that on a very personal level, we've thought about that. And we're taking those words and contextualizing them and projecting them on our entire planet and our entire species. So it makes it very personal. It also is very philosophical in some sense, right? We start talking about life and intelligence, and we ask, what does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to be intelligent? And why is there life and intelligence in the universe? Those are questions we don't know the answer to, and probably questions we can't answer. But we can talk about them and explore them through this conversation. And lastly, and this is the most important, and we'll come back to this, asking questions about life in the universe really makes us ask difficult and uncomfortable questions about ourselves. Because right now, we're the only life that we know of. And when we start imagining being part of a much larger context and a much larger cosmos, it makes you think a little differently about the way we handle ourselves and the way we do. Okay? So we'll talk a little bit about that throughout the talk. Okay? So this talk is really a framework. I'm going to tell you what I know as an astronomer and what we think as physicists, but it's a framework to hang these larger conversations on. Okay? And as we go along, you'll have questions, and you should feel free to ask them right then when they strike you in your mind. Because if you have the question, someone else has, and our goal here is to keep everyone on the bus between now and 8 o'clock. But I'll control the questions. If they start getting out of hand, I'll just kind of cut them off and we'll make sure we get to the end. But invariably, 2 weeks from now, at 2 in the morning, you'll wake up and you'll be like, oh, I wish I had asked Larson that. Okay? So, my email address is right here. It's there for a reason, okay? Please use it, send me questions, and we can certainly, whoa, I shouldn't push my hands too much, okay? Send me questions, and we'll get you the answers that we can, okay? You can tweet at me on Twitter if you're live tweeting tonight. Please tag me so all my followers see that you're here having fun and talking about weird and interesting things, okay? So, this is the context. So let me talk about the universe to start with, and then we'll talk about life. This is the framework, okay? So, this is a picture called the Hubble Deep Field. We took the Hubble Space Telescope. We found a place in the sky where we thought there was nothing. And we pointed the Hubble Telescope there for 40 days. And when we developed the picture, we found that the empty places in space are full of thousands and thousands of galaxies. And if I take that little tiny spot on the sky and I multiply it by the size of the entire sky, there are 500 billion galaxies in the cosmos. And every galaxy is not unlike the Milky Way. The Milky Way has 400 billion stars. So in total, in the cosmos, there are 100 billion trillion stars. Now you're laughing, right? And the reason you're laughing is because we say these words like we know what they mean. Trillion 100 billion times. Okay? Sure, no problem, Larson. Richard Feynman once famously said, we used to call these numbers astronomical numbers. Okay, but you all know we don't call them those anymore, right? We call them economical numbers. Because numbers like this are like the size of the national debt, right? But none of us knows what $1 trillion looks like. We act like we do, but we don't. Well, for every dollar in the national debt, there are 100 billion stars in the cosmos. Okay? Now, something that we've only known for maybe 10 or 20 years is that around every star,
there are indeed planets. Every star is a parent to a whole host of planets. And those of you who have grown up being science fiction nerds like I have always known that stars have planets. But we haven't known it. We haven't been able to demonstrate using astronomy that indeed there are planets around other stars. But there are. And so in all that cosmos, there are a trillion, trillion planets. Right? We're like, oh yeah, trillion. Not 2 trillion, a trillion times, right? A trillion, trillion worlds in all the cosmos. Now, in a trillion, trillion worlds, this is the only one on which we know with certainty there is life. This is home. This is where we live. And in all those enormously large numbers, it may be that there's one. But this is the only place we know with certainty that there is. Okay? Now, we take that for granted. This is home for us. This is Chicago at night, right? We all hang out, we live our lives, we have our fun, we eat awesome dinners that Mickey makes, right? We get together and we have big brain-bending conversations together, okay? And it's all done here in our city. And we don't think about the fact that over our heads, there are trillions and trillions of other worlds. But if there's ever a blackout in the city of Chicago, the very first thing you should do, besides tweet it out, the very first thing you should do is run outside. Because if there's a blackout in the city of Chicago, you will be able to see something that you cannot see tonight. The Milky Way stretching overhead. 400 billion stars in a gigantic arch holding up the sky above you. And there's nothing quite like standing out under the Milky Way and thinking about how small we really are and how small the Earth really is in all that vastness of space. How many of you have seen the Milky Way? Anyone? All right, I like that. Okay, so I grew up in the Rocky Mountains, right? I grew up every night, right? Going out my backyard, I can see this. Okay? I miss it in Chicago because it provides a perspective about life in the universe that you just don't get standing under the streetlights all the time. So if you can get out of the city, look up. If there's a blackout, look up, okay? So this is the context. And I want to start the evening then with a quote that we're gonna come back to, okay? From Arthur C. Clarke. Arthur C. Clarke was a famous science fiction author, although we often like to use the word for him, futurist. He's a person who, although confined by the technology and thinking of his time, was very good about looking forward and imagining what the consequences of the changes in our society and the changes in our technology would be. And he often thought about this question. He wrote science fiction stories about the question of whether or not there's life elsewhere in the cosmos. And he's famous for saying the following. There are two possibilities. Either we're alone or we're not. And both possibilities are terrifying. Okay? And I find that, I've always found that, an interesting choice of words. The idea that we're all alone in the universe, that's that personal emotional response I talked about, right? The idea of being alone is terrifying in many ways. Chuck Nolan crashing his FedEx plane, living on a desert island for 3 years all by himself? That would freak me out, right? But the idea that the Earth is the only world that has life on it, that could be a little freaky. But equally so, if we are only one insignificant world among trillions and trillions of worlds, all that bear life, that's kind of a big strike to the human ego, right? Mm-hmm. We think we're really important. But if we're only one of a trillion worlds, that could be a little bit scary. Okay? So I'm going to come back to this quote at the end, and we'll talk about it some more. But I want you to remember that Arthur C. Clarke saw that said that. Okay? So here's what we're going to do for the rest of the evening. Okay?
So I'm going to start by talking about, well, what might life be like? Okay, so this is kind of at the heart of that gut reaction to go grab your sketchbook and draw monsters and alien life forms, right? But I want to talk about what we actually think life might be like. And then I'm going to talk about whether or not we as scientists, as astronomers, can make a good estimate, a reliable estimate, about whether or not we think there are actually worlds where we might be able to talk to whoever lives there. Okay? So we call that SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Okay? Once you start going down that path, then you start asking, well, could I communicate with them? And we call that SETI, communication with extraterrestrial intelligence. Okay? And we'll talk a little bit about this at the end. Okay? Now, what is true about this subject is that we could talk about this for an entire day, and we still wouldn't talk about all the things that we could talk about. So I've made some choices here about things to have a conversation about, and there are many things that go beyond this, that are related to it, and that aren't related to it. And so if you have questions that go beyond this, ask them. If we can answer them, we will. If we can't, that's why Mickey's gonna feed us and let us talk afterwards. Okay? Okay, so. Let's start with what we know, okay? Humans almost exclusively dominate this planet. In biology, my colleagues have a term that they call an apex species, okay? So often you hear that term in the context of predators. There are species that rises to the top and they eat everything, but nothing else eats them, okay? Humans very certainly are an apex species. Whether or not we're predators or not, we can have that discussion later. Okay, but we're an apex species. We take over the planet, and we use it, and we don't really pay that much attention to the rest of the world. Okay, so this is a picture of Oak Park Beach, right off of Lakeshore Drive there, and this is our life, right? You look out, and there are lots and lots of humans. How many humans are on the planet Earth right now? Anyone know? It's a number we should know.
6 billion?
6 billion? 7 billion?
Seven.
Yeah. It's about 7 billion. Okay? 7 billion. Yes, just 7 billion. It's smaller than a trillion, right? Yeah. 7 billion. Now that number astonishes me. Because when I was wee, okay, so I'm about 40 now, but when I was little, okay, the number was 3.5 billion. In less than a human lifetime, we've doubled the number of humans on planet Earth. Now, as scientists, particularly if we're ecologists and we're energy scientists, we often talk about what we call the carrying capacity of the planet. What's the maximum number of humans the planet could support? Does anyone know that number? Okay, it's arguable about what it is. It's something like 10 to 12 billion. You'll find people who tell you it's 20, but it's probably somewhere in there, okay? In my lifetime, we doubled from 3.5 billion to 7 billion. And so it's not unreasonable to imagine that we could double to the carrying capacity of the planet before me and you are old and people are smuggling tacos to us in the nursing home. It's scary, right? Darling.
Is that taken into consideration for vacant space or space that's already populated?
Okay, so that's a great question. So the question is, what goes into that number for the carrying capacity? What goes into it? Is it just space? What is it? So it's actually about the dominant thing that goes into it is resource production. What do you need to sustain that many people on planet Earth? Food, energy, you know, transportation, medicine, all those things that we think are essential to sustaining our civilization. Okay? Other questions? You good? Okay, one more.
With climate change,
uh-huh,
and the acidity rising, mm-hmm, oceans, and like the valley going into,
yeah,
water, does that then lower the amount of resources that humans can...
Yeah, so the question is, how does climate change the carrying capacity of the planet? Now, I spent a little time thinking about climate change, too. It's a pressing problem, and I just think those of us who know things should think about pressing problems, right? My estimate of the answer to that question is we don't know the answer. And the reason for that is that the climate is changing, and it's changing the ecosystems of the planet dramatically, and in ways that we don't yet know what the permanent changes will be. So it's hard to say if Bordeaux becomes unable to grow grapes, will we ever be able to grow Bordeaux wine grapes somewhere else on the planet? We don't know the answer to that, okay? We seriously don't know the answer to that for sustainable crops like corn, wheat, the things that keep our civilization alive. So we don't know yet. Okay, let me take one more and then I'm gonna go on.
Is air taken into account in terms of natural resources, in terms of things that will sustain us, like oxygen levels?
Yeah, so the question is, what about kind of other chemical things that we depend on? Oxygen, right? So oxygen we don't worry about. I don't know if that's good or not. The thing that we actually worry about with regard to our civilization is actually potable water. Water is the biggest thing that drives where humans can and cannot live. And so having water that supplies a city like Chicago is a big problem. Okay? We're lucky, we got a big lake right there. Okay? So we draw water out of the lake and we don't even pay attention to how much we draw. Right? Los Angeles, they have a much bigger problem. Because they have to pipe water from really far away to get to Los Angeles. So that's probably the biggest other thing that we have to worry about. Okay? Okay. As I said, we're an apex species, but we're not the only species on the planet. When I look around the world, I see an amazing diversity of life. And not all of them look like humans. This is my 10-year-old.
Aww.
She was a Beanie Boo for Halloween last year, right? Okay. This was me. This is what I wear to class every day. Okay, but look at these life forms, right? Oak trees, daisies, slime mold. Okay? Squirrel. Okay. That's my cat, Zeno. Okay? Insects.
Anglerfish.
Who are the
bats?
Tardigrades, yeah. So water bears. Okay? And platypus. Right? The diversity of life on the planet is remarkable. It's amazing. Okay? All told, we estimate there are about 8.7 million different species of plants and animals on Earth. We don't know all of them. We've only categorized maybe an eighth of those, a tenth of those. Okay? And we're just guessing about the oceans. Okay? But the propensity of life on the planet is remarkable. Now, when we think about life on other worlds, this is what we're doing. We're looking at life on Earth and trying to imagine where it came from, where it's going, how it got the way it got. And then trying to use those ideas to imagine life elsewhere in the cosmos. And there's a very definite prejudice we have for life on Earth, because we know how life on Earth works. It's hard for us to imagine it working differently. And so lots of the things that we talk about come from our estimate of how platypuses and daisies actually live out their lives. But there's this remarkable unity among all the planets, among all the plants and animals on the Earth. Despite the fact that they all look different, deep down in their hearts, at the molecular core, at the chemical machinery level, all life on Earth is governed by a few basic chemicals and chemical processes. The master molecule of life on Earth for every one of the animals and plants you see on this screen is this: DNA. It's a molecule that has learned how to store information and read it out and copy it down, just like you and I do in the olden days with books. And now we do with Wikipedia and Google, right? This molecule knows how to store information and replicate it. And every single creature on this slide uses DNA to write those messages.
The oak tree knows how to read my DNA. I know how to read the DNA of an anglerfish. I take the information in the DNA and I put it together differently. That's why I don't have big, awesome fangs. Okay? But it's still the same language. It's just like books are all written in English, but The Lord of the Rings is very different than Steel Magnolias. Right? Same words, same language, but that's the difference between an anglerfish and an oak tree. Okay? And it's all due to this molecule. Now, how long have we known about DNA? About 60 years. Okay? In the 1950s, a brilliant scientist named Rosalind Franklin, this is her, she was working on trying to take pictures of the molecular machinery of life. She was doing something called X-ray crystallography. That's a big word to go home and tell your mom so she thinks you learned something important tonight. X-ray crystallography. She would take cells and extract the DNA, although we didn't know what it was then, and crystallize it, and then shine X-rays through it, and it would make these beautiful pictures like this. Okay, this is the very first picture of DNA ever taken. It's taken by her graduate student, Raymond Gosling. It's known as photo 51. The very first picture of DNA ever taken, you can see the helix structure there in the middle, and you can see the ladder of the genetic alphabet that encodes all the information about all life on Earth. Franklin's story is a very prominent one in the story of life because famously, someone showed Francis Crick and Watson photo 51. They immediately wrote a paper about the structure of DNA, and they won the Nobel Prize. But Rosalind Franklin's the one who figured out what it looked like. Okay, so we like talking about Franklin because she's the one who enabled the knowledge that you and I have, that life is controlled by this single master. Okay? Now, let's talk about life in a little bit broader context. Okay? We were talking about big stuff. Squirrels, anglerfish, stuff that we could see if it was here in the room with us. But there's a lot of life on the world that's microbial. Okay, this is a particular kind of microbe I like. Does anyone know what these are? They're called diatoms. Okay, so they have these crystalline shells that make very pretty pictures. See lots of art installations surrounding diatoms. How many microbes, not just diatoms, all microbes, how many microbes are there on planet Earth?
A trillion.
Yeah, a trillion trillion? Okay. Is that number too big or too small?
Too small.
Okay. There are 5 million trillion trillion microbes on the planet Earth. Okay, that number I told you, 8.7 million species, we have no idea how many species of microbes there are on Earth. But we know roughly how many there are. If I could sweep them all together and put them in a big pile, that's a better way to think about them, they would weigh 20 times more than every human on the planet put together. Do you want to know what life form rules the planet? It's the microbes. So when I start thinking as a scientist about life on other worlds, this is actually what I start thinking about. Because I know that the number of them on Earth is so enormous, and that they occupy so much of the biosphere on Earth, that if any life had to survive somewhere besides Earth and figure out how to do it, it's going to be one of these critters. Okay?
What makes it qualify as life?
Okay, what makes it qualify of life? Okay, that is an awesome question. Okay, so we have to make up some definitions. So I don't have a slide about this, so I'm going to tell you the few things that we think about, and I'm going to tell you an awesome story. Okay? So the few things that we think about, it has to, let's use a technical word, respire. It has to take in something that it then chemically transforms and gets energy out of. Right? You and I get energy from Halloween candy. And Mickey's food, once he's done cooking, okay? Okay? We take in complex things that we break down into sugars, and we break the sugars, and then we get our energy from them, okay? Beyond that, it becomes a little hard. It has to self-replicate. That kind of makes sense, except there are things that we don't think are alive that do self-replicate. So there are other definitions, okay? If we're talking about animals instead of plants, they have to locomote. They have to move, right? So this is debatable, and we argue about this a lot, okay? But the big thing is, you have to somehow take in material and make energy from it that you use for your own purposes, and you have to somehow replicate. Those are probably the two biggest.
So fire does.
Fire is an interesting question, right? We don't think of fire as alive, but this illustrates the difficulty. It would, in principle, obey those two parts of the definition.
And viruses?
Viruses are another example. We argue a lot about whether or not viruses are alive, okay? So I would certainly very much sit on the side that viruses are alive, because they carry genetic code with them that they use to make copies of themselves. Fire doesn't carry any genetic code with it, so that's maybe why I might eliminate fire, right? Okay, so let me tell you an awesome story. What was the first space probe to land on the planet Mars? Does anyone know? Not Kroger. 1976, two robot explorers from Earth landed on Mars called Viking 1 and Viking 2. And Viking was the first probe to successfully land on another planet, and its sole goal was to dig into the surface of Mars, collect some soil, and see if there were microbes, if there was life living in the soil. There were four life experiments on Viking, four chemical experiments that they did on the soil. There were actually five life experiments. The fifth experiment was the camera. Because if the camera was panning across Mars and you saw an elephant walk by, you'd know there was life on Mars. NASA, for some reason, doesn't count that. I don't know. So, okay. But there were four life experiments. And we as astronomers agreed, before we even launched Viking, that if the experimental outcomes were A, B, and C, then we would say there was life on Mars. So, we send Viking to Mars. Three of the four experiments say A, B, and C. So, we as scientists say, there's no life on Mars. Okay? We broke our own rules. And despite the fact that the experiments we had designed to detect life, because we had some definition of life that we thought, we decided that the outcome of those experiments did not authentically tell us there was life on Mars. And the reason was, when we got to Mars, there were things about Mars we didn't know. The surface of Mars is blasted every single day with ultraviolet light from the sun. There is no ozone layer on Mars to protect you if you live on the surface. And that dramatically changes the chemistry of the surface of Mars in such a way that it could fool our life experiments. And we didn't know that before we got there. Okay. So we think Mars probably is lifeless, because we've never seen something that we could convince ourselves was life and not some weird random chemistry goings on the planet Mars, okay? Okay, that's a good question. Okay, so microbes. Let me show you an awesome example of microbes' adaptability. What's this?
Yellowstone.
It's Yellowstone National Park. Does anyone know the name? This one's my favorite place in Yellowstone. It's called the Grand Prismatic Spring. Okay? You can see the boardwalk and the people walking on it to give you a sense of scale. Okay? So this is a natural spring in Yellowstone. The geothermal activity under the surface in Yellowstone heats the water to near boiling. It wells up in the middle of the spring and then spills out and washes down this direction to the Yellowstone River. Okay? What's with the colors? They're microbes. They're different species of algae. In the center is algae that is completely tolerant of temperatures near boiling. And they give it this bluish, turquoise, green color that you see. As you go out, that turns to yellow. Okay? The water, as it goes out from the center, cools. And so the algae that's yellow can't handle really hot water. It can handle water that's a little bit cooler. And as you go out, it gets even colder, and you get the orange and the red. If you are out here, the water temperature isn't any hotter than what you get out of your tap. Okay? So this is many, many different species of algae that have all robustly developed the ability to survive in an environment where you and I could not possibly survive at all. And microbes are awesome at this, and it takes them no time flat to figure out how to do it. Because humans change on the time scale that we have generations of humans, which is decades and centuries. Microbes change on the time scale that you have new generations of microbes, which is ours. Is there a question back there? I
was just going to ask if this is a thermal photograph, or is this
this is pure color. If you go, this is what you'll look like. This is my favorite place, right? I stand hours on end here waiting for the moment to see through the fog to take the picture of the Grand Prix Spring. This picture you can only get flying overhead, though.
Okay.
Right? It's huge, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But there are other awesome reasons to go to Yellowstone, too. Yeah, so this rainbow spectrum is the color of light that your eye can see, okay? And, you know, it might seem strange that the algae adopted those colors, but if you think about our planet, it makes kind of sense, okay? What's the color, the primary color in the sun? So white is the sum of all the colors, okay? But the individual color, what's the brightest color in the sun? Yellowish green. It's actually that green color that they paint construction vests and fire engines. Okay. Do you know why they paint construction vests and fire engines that fluorescent green color? It's what you can see the best. Because your eye evolved under the light of the sun. And so these algae, in a very similar way, have evolved under the light of the sun. And so it's very natural for them to be responsive and to generate the colors that the sun generates the easiest. It's complicated. Life is intertwined in very complex ways, and we're just figuring out what they are.
Are those all be classified as the archaea or archaea?
Yeah, you know, you'd have to talk to my biology friends. I don't know the exact words they use for all those, but they're algae of some sort. These are what we call algae mats. So they're colonies of algae that are even interwoven together.
What I was curious, are they the ones
The classification of plants and animals and algae and fungi and those things in particular, this is part of that story, absolutely. So we generically, in astrobiology, in astronomy, we generically call these kinds of things extremophiles.
Right.
They are creatures that have adapted to extreme environments. And whether or not they're plants or animals, we don't care, right?
Okay.
We care that they've adapted to an extreme environment. Okay. And there's many examples of this all over the planet. Okay? And we could have a whole talk about all the different examples of this that we can have. Okay?
One more example.
One more example? So one of my other passions in life is oceanography, because I think it would be awesome to go underwater and have submarines and stuff. And in the 90s, the 80s, Robert Ballard, who's a famous oceanographer, he's the person who discovered the resting place of Titanic. He discovered around geothermal vents on the bottom of the ocean, these are called black smokers, that they were growing colonies of life forms. And that was completely unexpected because around the geothermal vents, they're ejecting sulfurous compounds and the water is highly acidic because it has sulfuric acid in it. But the life forms there thrive in the acidity. They use the acid, they break it down to make energy. Okay. So, black smokers. Yeah, look them up. Okay. So if you go talk to your friends who are astrobiologists, this is what they're going to talk to you about. Okay? But what we care about, the thing that we want to talk about when we're having these conversations over drinks and over dinner while we're waiting for the evening to start, is alien life that we could talk to. We want to know about stuff like this. What? And this really illustrates the problem that we have. surface on Jupiter, so you'd have to be a big balloon. This is the Horda from Star Trek. They did pretty good, right? Right? If you had to live inside solid rock, you look like a pizza. Okay? So this is the problem with imagining life on other planets. We're very constrained by our prejudices here on Earth. But what we're actually interested in is there life like this to talk to?
Oh, just an observation of all these pictures. It's very interesting because all of these aliens seem to be, I don't know if predator is the word, but I have an understanding that in the wild, if you are usually prey, your eyes are on the side of your head. Mm-hmm. You need to be able to look, mm-hmm. and normally predators evolve to see.
Yeah.
So all of you guys have eyes on the front.
This is a very interesting aspect about our perceptions in popular fiction about alien life. Almost exclusively, if you read novels about alien life and you watch movies about alien life, it's adversarial encounters that we think about. We think they want to eat us. Okay? And it's debatable as to whether or not that's true. We don't actually know how alien life would respond to us. Because the only thing we know how to do is to project our own cultural values and cultural beliefs and our response to other life forms on an alien and imagine they think what we do. Okay? But we don't actually know that that's true. I think that's an interesting question, right?
Is there something in the fact that, like, so many of these are, like, it, for the most part, repulsive, in, you know, or, like, scary, or that it's, like, some way of dealing with anything that would be outside would have to be just beneath
us? Yeah. So the question is, why do we make things look repulsive, right? Because we don't know. Right? We just don't know what it should look like, right?
It's terrifying.
Tribbles.
Maybe. Tribbles? Yeah. Tribbles are so warm and fuzzy. They're so nice. Yeah. So, right. We try, but I think it's the answer to this question that I answered, which is, right, we present this through our fiction as adversarial. Okay? Now, let me tell you a story. So, I know it's hard to believe, but I go to Star Trek conventions now. Okay? And I once at the Star Trek convention had the good fortune of being called on during Bill Shatner's Q&A. Okay? And I asked Shatner what I regarded as a serious question. And much to my surprise, he gave me a serious answer, not a Shatner answer. Okay? And the question I asked him is, I said, Captain Kirk. I said, what does science fiction tell us about our future? And Shatner was very serious, and he said, you know what? I don't think science fiction tells us anything about our future. He said, all movies and all literature, and science fiction in particular, is telling us stories about ourselves today. It's a way for exploring what we think we're all about. And so I think there's serious questions to be asked about how we portray these things, because they're illuminating what we're afraid of, right? We're afraid that we're not the apex species in the cosmos. Right? Now, I will make a final note about this slide, which is, I put the platypus on here, no one does! But that's because a freaking platypus looks like an alien, right? Okay.
True.
So, what about life like us, okay? This is actually a serious question. This is a question that we as astronomers can actually give a serious answer to, okay? And the first person to think about this was this guy, Frank Drake, okay? Frank Drake is a radio astronomer. He was the first person to think seriously in the 1960s about whether or not we could in fact communicate with other civilizations. He did the first experiment to show that what we call communication without preamble is possible. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But he knew that if he was going to propose that we should see if there are other civilizations out there, he better have a good argument to suggest that we should spend our time and our technology trying to look for their signals. So he invented, I heard the statement over here, an equation that we call the Drake equation. And I on purpose didn't warn you before we started that we were going to do math, but I'm confident all of you can do this math, because all we're going to do is we're going to multiply. And the beauty of the Drake equation is that it's a particular kind of problem we encounter in physics a lot that we call a Fermi problem. If you all come take physics and astronomy from me, we always spend the first week doing Fermi problems. Fermi problems are questions that have definite answers that you have no business knowing what an answer should be. Okay? So the most famous Fermi problem is, how many piano tuners are in the city?
12.
Well, maybe, I don't know. I haven't done it for Chicago, okay? How many pizzas are consumed in Chicago every night? How many ballpoint pens are bought in Cook County every month? You don't know the answer to that. You could probably figure it out because I'm sure the Chamber of Commerce keeps track of ballpoint pens, okay? But the point in Fermi problems is that you can figure the answer out because those numbers depend on a few things that you do know. And so the Drake equation is one of these problems. How many worlds in the galaxy might have life that we could communicate with? We have no way to know what that number is, but it depends on things that we do know, okay? And those things that we do know are these seven numbers right here, okay? So we're gonna try and calculate this number, the number of planets with civilizations we could talk to. And to get there, we're gonna multiply all these seven numbers together.
What's the definition of civilization?
Okay, so we'll talk about that, okay? Because I'm gonna relax that criteria by the end, okay? So we'll talk about that. Okay, so the seven numbers are the rate at which stars form in the galaxy. Makes sense, we have to know how many stars there are. We kind of talked about that already. The fraction of stars that have planets around them. That makes sense, life has to have a place to live. The number of planets in the solar system that actually could support life. Well, that makes sense, okay? The fraction of planets that do develop life. The fraction of planets that develop intelligent life. The fraction of planets that develop the technology to communicate. And lastly, how long that life lives on a planet. Okay? So if I told you the value to all those seven numbers, you punch them into your calculator, multiply them together, and it tells you how many civilizations should be in the Milky Way galaxy. Okay? So let's do it. Okay. I always think about the first three numbers together because the first three numbers are easy. They're things that we as astronomers have figured out. We look at the galaxy and we know about six new stars are born in the galaxy every year. We used to not know this number, but in the last 10 or 20 years, we've discovered that every time we look at a star, we pretty much see planets, okay? Now, I'm interested in not being overly optimistic, so I'm gonna be conservative. So even though I actually think that every planet has stars, I'm gonna say maybe only half the planets, half the stars have planets, okay? And then lastly, I'm gonna use my knowledge of our solar system to say how many planets in the solar system are habitable, develop an ecosystem that could support life. In our solar system, there's three planets on where that should be possible. Venus, Earth, and Mars. Venus has had some trouble. Okay, they've had a runaway greenhouse effect that tells us a lot about what we should expect about climate change, okay? Mars has had a little bit of trouble, but it's actually probably habitable, and in fact, might be able to be transformed back into something you and I might recognize as Earth-like. That's an entire another question. Okay, and Earth, for the moment, is habitable. So I'm gonna say this number is 2, because that's what it is here at home. Okay, so if I multiply 6 times a half, that's 3, 3 times 2 is 6. Okay? You can do this.
Sure.
Okay. Now let's take each of the others one at a time. All the other numbers we're really going to guess at. And the only thing we have to guide our guesses is what we know about the Earth. So I'm going to frame all the other numbers about what we know about planet Earth. When I go out in my backyard and I look at the life around us, what do I think about what's going on in quantum? And I'm going to use that to make statements about these other numbers. Okay, and then we'll relax them and change them and we'll see how that affects our estimate. Okay, the first number, on what fraction of planets does life develop? Now, there are two camps of scientists on this matter. Some of us are very optimistic, and some of us are very pessimistic. But in this case, I'm going to argue that the optimist should win. And that's because when we talk about life developing, it's a question about chemistry. When I look at the chemistry of all life on Earth, the chemistry that underlies the master molecule, DNA, it's all built on a set of chemical compounds that we call amino acids. Amino acids make up all the superstructure of life on Earth, all the proteins, the nucleic acids. It's all built out of chemistry that's built around amino acids. And there are other organic compounds, as we call them, ethanol, methane, that sort of stuff. Stuff that has lots and lots of the basic chemicals that are essential to life, carbon, oxygen, hydrogen. And when I look out into the cosmos, I see lots of so-called organic compounds. But in particular, I see lots of amino acids. And so as a physicist, as a chemist who thinks about the way the world works, it's hard to imagine that the chemical processes that lead from amino acids to the basic micromachinery of life, the chemical micromachinery of life, is so uncommon that I have piles of amino acids all around the universe, it doesn't sometimes turn into life. So, I'm not going to be optimistic and I'm not going to be pessimistic. I'm going to be conservative. Okay? And I'm going to say that out of every 100 planets, because of this commonality of the stuff of life, out of every 100 planets, one will develop life. Is everyone okay with that? Is that conservative enough for everybody? Okay, I saw a hand floating around over here. Yes?
I've heard the term carbon-based life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What? I mean, I'm assuming that means it's based in carbon.
Yeah. But... So the question is, what does carbon-based life mean? So if I were to draw out all the chemical molecules that underlies the molecular machinery of us, the base molecule that holds it all together is carbon. Okay? Carbon is a great molecule for life because it's plentiful. It has many different bonding sites. It has four. And sometimes you can take two of those bonding sites together and make super strong bonds, which make really good deal for tough molecules, which you need in life sometimes, right? So life somehow had decided that carbon is the thing to base itself on. We have often speculated that you could replace carbon with other stuff. And science fiction certainly has explored this concept, in particular silicon, which has very similar chemical properties. We have often speculated could play the role that carbon plays here on Earth. Okay? That's speculative. We've never seen it happen. We don't know. But it's plausible. We don't know any reason to disbelieve it. Okay? Okay. Okay? So, one out of every 100 planets will develop life. How many planets develop intelligence? Okay, this is hard. Okay? Because we have to decide what we mean by intelligence. Okay? Now, we may or may not argue whether or not we are intelligent, but let's talk about my friend. Okay. What do chipmunks do in the winter?
They store their food.
They have giant underground burrows where all summer they pile food in, and during the winter they don't really hibernate. They just hang out in their burrows and they eat popcorn and watch Hill Street Blues. I don't know what chipmunks watch. Dancing with the squirrels, right? Okay. So, is that smart? Is that intelligence?
Yes.
Maybe, right? If you're a biologist, think about this. You ask the following question. Is that intelligence or is it instinct?
be really cynical, ask that question of us. Are we intelligent? We're destroying the biosphere of planet Earth. The thing that's keeping us alive. Is that intelligent? I don't know. I don't care. I got a new iPhone, right? Yep. So yeah, it's hard. It's hard to answer that question. So there are the optimists who say there absolutely is intelligent life. Because when I look around planet Earth, squirrels are smart, dolphins are smart, ravens are smart, my cat's smart, teenagers maybe not. Okay? There's lots of intelligent species on the Earth. And so maybe it's inevitable that if life arises, intelligence does too. And then there's the conservative and cynical and pessimistic people who say, no, maybe not. Okay, so again, I'm gonna be conservative. I'm gonna say for every pile of 100 planets that has life on it, only one will develop intelligent life. Okay? Okay. This is the big one. If we're going to talk to an alien civilization, they have to be able to develop technology so I can talk to them. And before iPhones and messaging, that technology is a radio approach. So, if you're intelligent, does that mean you develop technology? We don't know. On the planet Earth, humans have definitely developed technology. But it's quite clear, especially recently, that there are other species that are heading that way. Ravens take sticks and poke them in holes to pull out bugs. Stick is a piece of technology. It's something the raven used to change their life. There are chimpanzee troops in the world who are making tools from stone. The chimpanzees have entered the Stone Age. Okay? If I'm an optimist, I look at things like that and I say, it's inevitable that if you're smart, you will eventually develop technology. But if I'm a pessimist, I'm saying, no way. The dolphins have been here a freaking long time and they have not built scuba suits and radio so they can explore the land. Right? Okay, it's a hard question to answer. Okay?
I mean, is it based in terms of the type of technology you could develop? Like, if there was life in the, you know, the universe, and we couldn't connect with it because we just have no idea what that technology is.
So there's an interesting question here. Okay, so let me take that question and push it in a certain direction, which has to do with the way we communicate today with the way we communicated 20 years ago. 20 years ago, your parents had on their rooftop an antenna that the TV signal came into your house from, because all signals on planet Earth were broadcast with massive amounts of power over radio signals that we received on antennas. And all of those signals went out into outer space. Today, communication happens over fiber optics links, over low power radio, that goes to a magic device you carry around in your pocket. And the signal from this device is not going to make it to another star system. It is very possible that the radio signature from our civilization is slowly dying away. So that 200 years from now, no civilization out there may be able to hear us, because we've transformed our technology. So even if you don't develop this kind of technology, you could still develop this technology, and we'd never know the difference. The point here is that you have to be capable of building technology that could be used to send a purposeful signal into space. Okay? And so that, and we'll come back to that point in just a minute. Okay? Okay, so I'm gonna be conservative. You all know what I'm gonna guess, right? If I have a pile of 100 planets with intelligent life on them, 1 in 100 of those planets will develop technology capable of making a radio telescope. Okay? This is the big one.
how long does a civilization exist on a planet such that it's capable of talking to another world? And we argue a lot about this. There are pessimists, absolutely, because we know we are perfectly capable of destroying our civilization. There are tens of thousands of nuclear weapons on this planet. And despite the fact we've kind of forgotten about them, because the Cold War is over, they're still out there. And they could be used to destroy the planet. The optimists like to think that this number should be huge. It should be 10,000 years or more. But the pessimists think it should be really, really short. So I've chosen this number 5,000 years because the oldest civilization on our planet was the Indus Valley Civilization. And 5,000 years ago, they were a thriving civilization with cities and marketplaces and an economic support structure that funded food and, you know, all of the things that we recognize as modern civilization into the cities of the Indus Valley. And today, there's nothing left of them. Because they were incapable of dealing with the fact that the climate changed. The climate in the Indus Valley changed, the agricultural support structure collapsed, and the cities evaporated because they couldn't support all those people. Today, we have the technology to avoid that. I can ship you a banana from Ecuador, right? But in the olden days, they couldn't, and so that civilization is gone. We could absolutely destroy ourselves, and if you're a pessimist, you think we may. There are even more serious problems, which we alluded to earlier, which is the changing climate, which we are very clearly responsible for. This picture here is called the heat anomaly map. It shows how much in the last year the average temperature on the surface of the Earth has changed compared to the historical average. And everywhere that it's red is more than a degree centigrade. Remember we said Venus has a serious problem? This is what happened to Venus. Okay? Now, we don't know that there were Venusians responsible for it, okay? But it's quite clear you can terraform a planet and make it uninhabitable. So it may still be that we aren't going to be here for 10,000 years because we may make the planet inhospitable, okay? So that's probably too conservative, but let me use it for a minute to show you what the result is, okay? So if I take all those numbers and I multiply them together, I get 0.03. That number is consistent with zero. It means there are no civilizations in the galaxy besides us. It could be that we are utterly alone. Either because life is rare and I was too conservative, or because life could not work through the kinds of problems that we are facing today. We don't know. But it could be that we're utterly alone.
So by that you mean that there are civilizations that we have any possibility of ever communicating with,
yeah.
Not that ever exist.
There's not. Yeah, so that's another question, and we'll come back to that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's a good question. Because the lifetime is in that number.
Right.
So there could have been civilizations that lived for 5,000 years, but what this means is right now, at this moment, they're not there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there was another question, sorry.
Didn't you say there were like bajillions of galaxies as well?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if those are out of the equation.
Yeah, so what this number means is that I need 100 galaxies before I find one galaxy that has a civilization in it that's alive right now.
But we have how many right now?
But there's 500 billion galaxies, okay? So what that means is there's 5 billion civilizations out there in other galaxies. Sure, no problem, 5 billion. Okay, last question.
So you may talk about this later, but in the movie Contact,
yep.
She is asleep, and
uh-huh.
Suddenly a little beeping sound happens,
mm-hmm.
and she realizes that it's another galaxy.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. What is the actual SETI protocol, and like, what is the actual chance?
Okay, I'm going to talk about that in just a minute.
You will, okay.
Okay? following observation. I used the number 5,000 for how long we're going to be here. But if I look at the dinosaurs, they were on Earth for 170 million years. The dinosaur civilization, such as it was, lived on Earth for 170 million years. So imagine I go back to my Drake equation, and I keep everything exactly the same, except I change 5,000 to 170 million. And if I do that, there are 1,000 civilizations right now, today, out there in the galaxy that we could talk to. Because I'm an optimist, right? This could be the truth. The galaxy could be teeming with friends that we could talk to. Okay? Now, there's something to take away from that. And the thing to take away from that is that what I'm actually talking about is there someone for me to talk to? That comes from our rabid fascination with talking to each other all the freaking time. Okay? But what if I didn't care about talking to them, right? What if I asked a different question? What if I just asked, how many planets have life, period? Forget about intelligent life, forget about communicative life. I just want to know how many planets have life so that I can go grow space carrots and have a little garden and enjoy myself. Okay? So, if I go back to the Drake equation, I'm going to use the exact same equation, but I'm going to say, forget about intelligence and forget about communication. Rather than 7 numbers, I'm going to multiply together 5 numbers. And because I like dinosaurs, I'm going to keep this number the lifetime of the dinosaurs. Because what I'm really asking is not a place where can I grow space carrots. I'm asking, can I find a planet with freaking dinosaurs on it? Okay? So I'm going to take all of those numbers and the dinosaur lifetime. And I get 10 million planets. There are 10 million planets in the Milky Way with dinosaurs on them. That makes the little kid in me very happy. Okay? This is completely reasonable. Right? Because I was conservative in all the numbers I put into this. This number could be 1 million times larger, but it seems unlikely that it's 1 million times smaller. It's very likely, from our perspective, that we should be encountering planets where there's complex life. Okay? Now, the dinosaurs, of course, are still with us. They've evolved into birds and reptiles and lizards. We eat them for dinner sometimes. Okay? And so, if they're still around us today, there's no reason why in the future that they might evolve into smart dinosaurs and have spaceships and airplanes. Okay? So once I start going down that path, then I come back to the question that was asked over here. Okay? If I'm going to assume there's plenty of life in the cosmos, what I really want to know is, could I send them a message? And the answer is yeah. Because we built radio telescopes. And as it turns out, we've done it. Up until last month, this was the largest radio telescope in the world. Yes. This is Arecibo in Puerto Rico. Okay. 300 meters across. The Chinese have now built one that's 500 meters across. But Puerto Rico is still the big one that we all have access to. Okay? This is what it looks like built out Lego. Legoing is my other hobby. Okay. In 1974, we took the Arecibo telescope and we sent a message into outer space. That message was designed based on principles that Frank Drake invented that said communication with someone who doesn't know your language and doesn't know your culture is possible. Because we all are viewing the universe, if we're using technology, through the lens of science. And so that means if you've built a radio telescope, you understand math and you understand physics. And if I build my message around the principles of math and physics, then there's some hope, if you receive it, you'll be able to interpret it. So I'm going to tell you about the message he sent from Arecibo. And Drake, to prove this was possible, made a message that before he sent it from Arecibo, he wrote it on a piece of paper and sent it to 50 of his friends without any indicator that it was from Frank. Although I'm pretty sure if you're Frank's friend, you could have figured out it was from Frank, okay? But you just get this message in an envelope, and all 50 of his friends figured out what the message contained and what it said. That convinced him that the story I'm about to tell you was possible. Okay? So, the message was sent towards the globular cluster in Hercules. Okay, some of you who were at Solanathon with us may have seen this through the telescope. It's a cluster of 500,000 stars that orbits the Milky Way in this giant snowball. Okay, it's about 25,000 light years away. And the message consisted of 1,679 digits, where the digit was either a zero or a one. Okay, and here it is. So what do you think? Yeah, right? It's an awesome message, right? Okay. This was sent out over radio. So you're sitting out there with your radio telescope. Man, I'm looking in the backwaters of the galaxy, and you get this signal from us, although you don't know it's us. Okay? Do you want to hear what it would sound like if you piped the radio signal through your radio? Okay, if our speaker's working, we'll do it. Freaking aliens! I discovered aliens! Okay, you want to hear it again? Okay, one more time. Question about contact was, you know, Jodie Foster was listening to her headphones and heard something. Okay, this is an example of something that someone getting a message from us is going to hear. Okay, now it doesn't sound like a message, but when you compare it to the normal stuff you hear from the cosmos, there's actually structure in it. So let me show you the structure. Okay, it is, well, sorry, let me tell you what the message is. Okay, then I'll tell you. Okay? So the message is actually a picture, because it doesn't do any good to send words. So what you should do is you should imagine the numbers being pixels. You should line them up in rows, and if the number's a one, you color it in, and if the number's a zero, you leave it blank. Okay, so here's an example. There's nine digits. I make a grid, I write the digits, and then I color them in. And I just sent you a big X. Because X marks the spot, right? So this is the idea behind the Arecibo message, okay? Is that all those ones and zeros, when you heard pulse when I played the sound, that's a one. When it was quiet, that was a zero. Has in it a kind of picture, okay? So, 1,679 is 23 times 73. That's the only way to write that number down. And if you understand math, you'll figure that out. Okay, so if I make 23 rows, 73 columns wide, this is what the message looks like. It makes a perfect square. If I color in all the ones, this is what it looks like. And if you saw that, you'd be like, nope, didn't see aliens today. But if I write it the other way, if I make it 73 rows tall and 23 wide, you start to see some magic. You see the patterns in there? Okay? That is not random. And if I color it in, you can see what it looks like. Okay. This is the kind of message that Frank sent his friends that they all figured out. And every piece of this message tells us something important about the people, the aliens, that sent the message into the cosmos, okay? Out here at the top, these white pixels, those tell you how, in this message, we count from 1 to 10. The numbers here, these are written using this notation, the numbers 1, 6, 7, 8, and 15, which if you know anything about chemistry, are the atomic numbers of hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, which are the main atoms in DNA. This is telling whoever receives this message something about our chemistry. so they know if we're digestible. Okay. This is all the chemical structure of the basic DNA nucleotides. So they can clone us. This is a picture of the DNA helix, and this tells you how many rungs on the DNA ladder there are. Okay? This is a picture of the human. On the left, it tells you what the typical height of a human is. And on the right, it tells you the population of planet Earth, which in those days was about 3 billion. Okay? This is a map of the solar system. Okay, the third planet is offset, so you know where the food lives. Okay. Now, luckily, Pluto's been demoted, so they'll never be able to find us. Okay. And lastly, this is the Arecibo telescope with a number that tells you how big it is. The telescope that sent the message. Okay. This message is cruising through space right now, broadcasting to whoever is capable of hearing it that we're here and we're trying to talk to you. Okay? Now, the obvious question then is if we're sending messages out, we probably should be listening. And have we ever heard any? Okay, so maybe you have heard of SETI and you know that SETI is constantly looking for signals. SETI has never detected a signal that we're confident is an alien civilization talking to us. But we have seen signals that are completely unexplained. And the most famous one was detected in the 1970s by this telescope in Ohio called Big Ear. Okay, so Big Ear was listening, and in 1974, I should remember that year, I'm sorry I don't, we saw this signal that we call the WOW signal. Okay, it's called WOW signal, because the astronomer who was watching the data saw this in the data, realized it was a big signal, circled it, and wrote WOW next to it. So we call this the WOW signal, okay? Now, if I plot what this signal looks like, it looks like this, okay? All the other bits of this data are down here, like this. Okay, you can't see them because we've chopped the graph off. But this very clearly was a very bright signal coming from the center of Milky Way galaxy. We know of no astrophysical phenomena that can produce this signal. So what is it? Someone trying to get our attention? Were they trying to send us a message and then we didn't listen afterwards and get the rest of the message? Is it the end of a message? Who knows? But we have no way of explaining this. And every few years, you'll hear some astronomers who say, oh, this was totally some comets exploding. And then we go look at all the orbits of the comets, and we're like, nope, there were no comets. So we're stuck again. What was it? It's a super bright radio signal, exactly of the sort that we sent out into the cosmos ourselves. And people want to argue, well, it can't be from an alien civilization, because they never repeated the frickin' thing. We have never repeated the Arecibo signal. Right? Mickey?
Are we constantly monitoring the place where that came from initially?
Yeah. No. The question is, are we constantly looking where this came from? No.
Why?
Why?
Why not?
Why? Yeah. Yeah. Because it costs money.
Oh.
And then my other question is, the new big radio telescope in China, Are they sharing time with?
Yeah, so the Chinese, the big telescope in China, is now the biggest radio telescope in the world. The Chinese are an interesting group to work with. They're very secretive about their science projects until they're done and working. And the US in particular still does not have normalized relations with the Chinese. So it's often difficult for American researchers to work with them. Okay. They are, however, dedicating some of the time on their telescope to looking for signals from alien civilizations. Okay? So they're going to do it, and we'll see. Okay? Okay. So we're just out of time, So let me leave you with a few things to read. Okay. These two books are very recent books that I think are quite nice. This one called The Eerie Silence is by Paul Davies, and this one called 5 Billion Years of Solitude is by Lee Billings. And so these books are both very nice because they incorporate into them all the latest things that we know about exoplanets and astrobiology and chemistry and all these things that we're thinking about. So if you want a nice modern view, these are nice books to read. It was mentioned earlier, the movie Contact, it was originally a novel written by Carl Sagan. This is an absolutely astounding movie and book because I think he, more than anyone else, took a very authentic view about how scientists would respond to the detection of life on another world.
And didn't he send a message also from the Arecibo Observatory?
So Sagan was involved in this quest to send and messages out. So this was during his prime, and he was a planetary scientist and very interested in this. Yeah, he was involved in it. He was also involved, I didn't tell you guys this story, there are plaques on the Voyager and Pioneer spacecraft, and Sagan was involved in the development of those. So that if aliens stumbled across our spacecraft, they would also be able to find out things about us.
The golden record
on Voyager, yeah. Okay? This is a book that I like very much. It's called The Oldest Living Things in the World. Rachel Sussman went around the planet and found the oldest living organisms she could and took pictures of them. And then she wrote this book, and so there's things in there with the pictures and the writings about the book. And so there are ancient forests, there are moss beds, there are algae beds, there's coral reefs. It's a fantastic book that really puts into perspective how short a time we have been on the planet. Okay, so I really like that book. And lastly, this is Peter Mulvey. He's a folk musician who lives in Milwaukee, actually. And he is he's famous for a lot of things, but this is my favorite song he ever wrote. It's called Vlad the Astrophysicist. He has an actual physicist friend, someone like me, who's a friend with artists like you, right? Who he likes to sit out behind hotels when they meet and drink beer and talk about physics. Okay, and so this song is about a conversation he had with Vlad about life elsewhere in the cosmos. And it very accurately captures how to think about that number that is so small, that's zero. It captures the notion that there may have been civilizations elsewhere, but they just aren't there now. Okay? So it's a fantastic song. You can find it on YouTube. This particular screenshot is from the version I like. He also did a version of it at TEDx in Kansas City. Okay? Those of you who are on Kickstarter, they're turning the song into a book. The Kickstarter ended today, so the book will be available eventually. Okay. Okay. So, let me close with the quote we started with, but from a different person. Okay? Buckminster Fuller said exactly the same thing that Arthur C. Clarke did. He said, sometimes I think we're alone, and sometimes I think we're not. But what Buckminster said was, in either case, I think that thought is staggering. Not that it's terrifying, but that it really makes you think hard about the cosmos and our place within it. And when I think about life elsewhere in the universe, and I imagine becoming part of a greater community of civilizations that span the galaxy, that's what I think about the most. I think about always, if we're alone or if we're not, how do we account for ourselves and how we present ourselves and what we do here on planet Earth. Okay? So, I'm going to end there and say thank you very much.